Anyway, thank you, Randy, for the new song. We are in a series, and you know, it's in the letter of 1 John. John has written a letter to Christians, most scholars believe, in the city of Ephesus. And what John's emphasis is his desire for every one of us who name the name of Jesus to have authentic marks of a true child of God. Because each one of you have the authentic marks of your family deep and embedded in your DNA. Your family is part of who you are. It's there, and you cannot hide that. You can't change your DNA. And so what John is asking these Christians, in light of some false teaching that's going on, in light of some opposition that's coming your way, you need to live faithfully, honestly, and genuinely live out your faith. And that hasn't really changed in 2,000 years. The call for you and I, the call for every believer in Lassen County and Honey Lake Valley, the call for every church is to live authentically and genuinely, live out your faith to the world that is around us. And this is what John is calling them to. He says, hold fast to the things you know are true. We're going to talk a little bit about those things this morning. We know that right beliefs is an indicator of a believer's faith. The right belief, it's an indicator of genuine Christianity. Today, John's going to talk about Antichrist. We're going to talk a little bit about the opposition that's against us in the world, right? You go out there, you find a little opposition, or is that just me? No, there's opposition out there. Opposition in this world that is pushing back against the kingdom of God. But what John tells us is that we have an obligation to push back. We have an obligation. We have a power within us called the Holy Spirit, God actually dwelling in us, that gives us the authority and the power to push back the darkness and share God's wonderful light. That's what we're going to look at today. So if you need a Bible, raise your hand. Anybody need a Bible? Jim Berry's back there. Raise your hand nice and high. And they'll bring you a Bible. Once you get that Bible, turn to 1 John chapter 2. It's towards the back of your Bible. You can find it there. If you got a phone, if you got an iPad, electronic Bible, go ahead and turn that on. Just stay off of Facebook while I'm preaching. That's all I ask. And if you do post a picture of me, make sure it's flattering, just so you know. Anyway, so you get the idea, right? So we're going to begin with a serious issue that John begins to talk about. Because here's one of the things that John has emphasized earlier in his letter to the church. We need Bibles over here, Jim. You got no help? Danny Brusatoy, bring a couple over here, can you? All right. Oh, Jim, you're coming this way. What are you doing? Okay. Okay, never mind, Danny. Jim's decided to come this way. Over here, brother. Oh, you got more there? Jeez. Wow. So what'd you do in church today? Well, it took a half hour to pass out Bibles. All right. So, yeah, I know. So it's a serious issue. And this is one of the things John has asked us from the beginning of his letter. Take your faith seriously. Because the things that we take seriously are going to be the things that we do the best. If you don't take your diet seriously, guess what? If you don't take your exercise program seriously, guess what? Right, Big C? You got to take those things seriously. No, I'm talking because Big Steve, I mean, that's why we call him Big Steve. Not because he's a 98-pound weakling. Call him Big Steve because he's thick. So, anyway, serious is what John has called us to be about our faith. And we start with this word in chapter 2, verse 18. John says, dear children, the last hour is here. Dear children, my beloved friends, those of you who are near and dear to me, those who I love with all my heart, dear children, John makes a statement, the last hour is here. So what I want to do, first of all, is kind of unpack this, because in our world and in our culture, we get a lot of crazy ideas about the last hour, about the last days. And most Bible scholars believe we're talking about, this is a phrase about the last days. And when somebody says, oh, the last days is here because Obama is president, the last days is here because there's 16 blood moons in 1 month, oh, the last days are here because, stop all of that. Scripture says, no man knows the hour, no man knows the day, not even the Son knows when his return is. Only the Father's. The Father. What can I assure you of? We are 2,000 years closer to the end than John was. That's what I can assure you of. Now, does the blood moon mean Jesus is coming? I have no idea. All I know is that I'm closer to Jesus returning than John was. It's been 2,000 years. And John says these are the last days. So what is John talking about? He's talking about when Jesus ascended, that began a new era. The new era of the Holy Spirit. The Old Testament has particular things that are true to the Old Testament. The New Testament has particular things that go with the New Testament. When Jesus ascended, he promised to send a comforter. That initiated these last days. And in these last days, the Holy Spirit guides us and empowers us and strengthens us. So John says, these last days began when Jesus ascended. These last days will end when Jesus returns. So the time in between is where we are living. The time in between Jesus' ascension and Jesus returning is the last days. And as I said, we're closer now than we were. We're 2,000 years closer. But is Jesus coming this week? Probably not. He could last 2,000 more years before he comes back. And we are wrong when we walk around and say, oh, Jesus, come back quickly and get us out of this mess. That is a selfish perspective. That is not the perspective a believer should have, because God is not willing that any should perish. And if we try to make Jesus hurry up and come back, what about those that aren't with us yet? Oh, I didn't think about them. Well, start thinking about them. Jesus, wait a little longer. Until my family comes into your kingdom. Jesus, wait a little longer until my neighbors come to faith. Jesus, wait a little longer until those that are my friends can come in to know your grace and be part of your kingdom. Jesus, just wait a little longer so we can keep doing what we need to do, which is bring people into his kingdom. Jesus, can you wait? Because we got a lot of work to do, amen? There's a lot of people that still need to come to faith. There's still more of them out there than in here. So Jesus, can you wait? Oh, we're in the last days. It's not good out there, right? It's not good out there. So this is what we're talking about. But as we look at this statement, dear children, the last hour is here. This moment is the last hour for somebody somewhere, isn't it? Pastor Steve shared about our brother Dave Barbarick taking the feeding tube out of him today. His days are numbered. Right now is the last day for somebody. This is the last moment for somebody somewhere. So as I look at what John says here, dear children, the last hour is here. For me, this is a call to urgency. Church, time is running out. And today, in Lassen County, somebody's going to expire in Lassen County today. And whether or not they know Jesus, their time has run out. So as I look at this, dear children, the last hour is here. To me, this is an urgent call for the church to be the church. For me, this is an urgent call for the church to love their neighbor. For me, this is an urgent call for the church to proclaim the blood and the salvation that's found in Jesus Christ. For me, this is a wake-up call for all of us. I hope it is for you. Dear children, you've heard the last hour is here. Let's continue on in verse 18. You have heard that the Antichrist is coming, and already many such Antichrists have appeared. From this we know that the last hour has come. In the New Living Translation, there's a distinction between the first Antichrist, which is a capital A, and the second phrase, Antichrist, which is a small a. I think this is appropriate because there is an Antichrist who is coming at the end of time, who is going to rise up against the church of Jesus Christ. We're familiar with those teachings in Revelation about Armageddon and about the end of days and those things. And so this Antichrist, we've been exposed to that term throughout the years. How many of you are old enough to remember when some people believed Henry Kissinger was the Antichrist? Remember that? What's wrong with us? And then, of course, every pope that comes along, the pope is the Antichrist. We've heard that one as well, right? So here's the thing. We don't know who the Antichrist is. Could he be here now? I have no idea. But I know this, is that one day somebody is going to rise up and they're going to fool the nations of the world and they're going to draw people away from the faith. That is the Antichrist who will do battle. And you know what the word anti means? It means opposed or against, right? We're anti something. You know, in Susanville, we're anti stoplights. We don't like stoplights, right? Or whatever we are here. But you understand, anti is opposed or against. So there is this one Antichrist who is coming with a capital A. But yet right now, John says, there are many Antichrists with a little a in our world. There are many opposing the Christian faith today. That poor little lady down in Kentucky, all she wanted to do was be true to her faith in God. And the pressure that has come against her, the powers that are pushing back against her, that spirit is here. And one of the things that John does when he uses this word, John is the only person in the Bible that uses the word Antichrist. What does John mean by Antichrist? First of all, he means the spirit in the world that opposes or denies Christ. That's what that little gal in Kentucky ran up against. In our world, in our culture, there is a spirit that is pushing us back. In our world, our culture wants the church to sit down, shut up, and be quiet. Our world would be happy never to hear, well, in America, they would be happy to never hear from the church again. But that's not what we've been called to. There's a spirit and a power against us. Antichrist also means false teachers who hold to this idea. It's unfortunate that in many churches and within the Christian faith today, there is false teaching going on in the Christian church. False teachers who deny that Jesus is God in the flesh, false teachers that deny that Jesus died for the sins of the world, and they preach that and they teach that, and people are led astray as a result of that. And this is what John is fighting against. And then lastly, the Antichrist, the capital A Antichrist, is the person who will head up the final world rebellion against Jesus. So, this spirit is here. These people are here. There is a movement to push back the kingdom of God. Look with me now at verse 19. These people, or these antichrists, they left our churches, but they never really belonged to us. Otherwise, they would have stayed with us. When they left the church, it proved that they did not belong to us. I love John's reasoning. He talks in circles. That's how I talk. I talk in circles. I say the same thing six different ways. And that's what John says. He says, these people, these antichrists, left the church, but they never really belonged to the church. Otherwise, they would have stayed in the church, but they didn't stay in the church because they didn't belong to the church. You understand that? Man, even I get that. So those who left the faith, those who left the faith community, were never really part of the faith community. You see, they had the external markings of the church. They had the external markings of the Christian faith, but their heart had never been transformed. Their inner life had never been changed to bring new life. They had never encountered the saving grace of Jesus Christ. They have never encountered the indwelling or the filling of the Holy Spirit. They were here amongst us, and they sang with us, and they waved their hands with us, and they carried a Bible, and they looked like they were interested. They acted like they were interested, but they really weren't. Because there was a time when a certain time came, they left, and they went out from us. So it's not our job to judge who's in and who's out. But John does tell us there are indicators to prove who's with us and who's not with us. Because there's Christians sitting at home today watching football and watching NASCAR. Why are Christians sitting home today when the Bible, not only the Bible, but John is very clear and specific that the place for God's people on God's day is to be together, worshiping, fellowshipping, and encouraging each other. Oh, but Pastor Rick, you don't understand. Today's Talladega. Really? Really? I saw Ricky Bobby. I know what Talladega, you know. That's why God gave us DVRs. Just so you know, pay the extra $4 a month and get the DVR. I'm just here to help you. You see, people came and they left. And what does that tell us? John says, when they come and they leave, there is something in their spirit that isn't as it should be. When they come and they leave, there's some struggle there that has not been resolved. And as one Bible scholar put it, he says, for if they were from us, but they weren't, they would have remained with us, but they didn't. Now, does that mean that you can't leave a church? That's not what John's talking about. What John's talking about is that those who walk away for good. I'm not talking about somebody that moves from community church to Nazarene church. That's not what we're talking about. Because we all should be in a place where we feel comfortable. We all should be in a church that is meeting our needs. We all should be in a church where we feel like we're a vibrant part of what's taking place there. And if it's not a community church, I encourage you to find a church where you do feel comfortable, where you can do what you want to do, where God is working in and through you in the ministry of that local church. So John's talking about people that came in and acted like Christians, but when they had enough, they walked away. They walked away. Verse 20, he continues. And here's the contrast. Notice what he says. But you are not like that. You are not like what? You are not like those little antichrists that show up and then leave. You're not like them. Why? Because the Holy Spirit, the Holy One God has given you his spirit. The Holy Spirit, the Holy One God has given you an anointing. The indwelling of the Holy Spirit. And all of you know the truth. You know all things. You have biblical knowledge. So I am writing to you, not because you don't know the truth, but because you know the difference between truth and lies. What is John saying? John calls Christians to remain faithful in the truth that has been given to you from the beginning. What truth has John given us from the beginning? Jesus was born of a virgin. Jesus lived a sinless and perfect life. Jesus died on the cross for the sins of the world. Jesus rose on the third day. Jesus is coming back. That is the truth of the gospel. That has been the truth from the beginning. And how does John know? He was there. How does John know? He walked with Jesus. How does John know? He stood at the tomb. He stood at the cross. John knows because he was an eyewitness to these things. So John says, these are the things that I've taught you from the beginning. These are the truthful things about Jesus Christ. These are the teachings that make up the whole of the gospel. You know them, hold to them, and don't waver. Don't let somebody come in and tell you, well, you know, Jesus was a good man, but he wasn't perfect. Don't let somebody walk in and say, well, Jesus was created by God to be an example for you and I. Jesus wasn't created by God. Jesus existed from eternity past as God. He is God and will always be God. Because the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, that's the triune God. As long as there's been a God, there's been the three of them. That's why when we read in the book of Genesis, when God says, let us make man in our image, he's talking about three of them in the Trinity. Let's make man in our image. God didn't say, let's make man in my image. God said, let's make woman in our image. And what is God's image? God's image is one that lives in community. Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. What was the first thing God did when Adam was by himself? Well, you need a partner. Because Adam, life isn't as exciting by yourself. I've told you this story. Imagine going to Disneyland by yourself. Right? Everybody else having a good time. Everybody's standing there laughing, man. They're eating nacho chips and all kinds of stuff. And they've got their family and kids. They're doing selfies. You know, here's me and Mickey and me posting stuff all over Facebook. And there you are standing by yourself. Got a little slushy. Then you step up to the ride. And every ride at Disneyland's got room for how many? Two. And they say, how many? And you say, one. So they put you in there by yourself, empty seat next to you, everybody's looking. What's wrong with that guy? He ain't got no friends. So you're going on the Matterhorn, Everybody else is bunched there screaming and yelling, got their arm around their wife, their kids, their family, their friends. And there you are in the cart by yourself. Whee. Whee. Oh, let me take a selfie of me by myself. Whee. God looked at Adam. He said, you need somebody to go to Disneyland with you. And so he created Eve because God understands community. God understands fellowship. And this is what he's talking about here. He says, you understand the truth. You know the truth. And that's that we are created for fellowship with God through Jesus Christ. He says, you know the truth because the Holy Spirit indwells you. And when the Holy Spirit indwells you and he indwells me, we have a relationship. And you can go to the church in Ecuador. You can go to the church in China. I can go down to Honey Lake Assembly and my spirit will bear witness with their spirit. And we will be blessed and we will love each other and we will celebrate the love of God. That's what the Spirit does. And he says, you know the truth because the Spirit indwells you. And so, what does John want these believers to know? Understand that Jesus is God. When you read the Old Testament and you hear them talk about Yahweh, you hear reading the Old Testament about the Father, Jesus is that God in the flesh. Jesus is God. The God of the Old Testament is the Jesus of the New Testament. He's God in the flesh. And we learn this from the historic, apostolic, orthodox teachings of Scripture. For hundreds of years, men smarter than you and I have argued and arm wrestled the truths of Scripture. They've created creeds and confessions that the church today holds dear because that's where we get our direction. From Scripture and the truth of Scripture, which has been expressed throughout history properly. It's been expressed accurately. So, you are not like that. The Holy One is giving you His Spirit, and all of you know the truth. So I am writing to you, not because you don't know the truth, church, but because you know the difference. You know the difference. Verse 22, and who is a liar, John says? Who are the liars? Look at verse 22. The liars is anyone that says Jesus is not the Christ. If they say Jesus is not God in the flesh, that person's a liar. Get away from them. Don't listen to them. Have nothing to do with them. Anyone who says Jesus is not the Christ is a liar. Anyone who denies the Father and the Son is an antichrist. Why? Because the Father is God, the Son is God, the Spirit is God, but the Father is not the Spirit, the Spirit is not the Son, and the Son is not the Father. That's called a triune God. God exists in three distinct personalities, but yet there is one God, there is one Father. Who's the liar? The person that tries to say Jesus is not God. Who's the liar? The person that says the Father did not send the Son. Verse 23, anyone who denies the Son doesn't have the Father. So if you don't understand Jesus Christ the Son properly, you'll never understand God the Father properly. And if you don't understand God the Father properly or Jesus the Son properly, you'll never understand the Holy Spirit as He lives and indwells inside of us. You see? You cannot accept the Father without the Son. They are one and the same. They are part of the triune God. You see? But John points out that all true Christians know God personally. All true believers have this transformed inner life that has moved them from darkness to God's light. All true believers know who they used to be and who they are today. How do I know God exists? Well, I look down at Steve Gaither. It's just that easy. How do I know that Jesus is real? Well, I look over at Skeeter White. He's not the man he was. He'd been changed, transformed from the inside out. And then, of course, I got to look at Dana. Not the woman she used to be. Transformed by the power of God. And I guess if you want, you can look at me. I'm not who I used to be because I was on a downhill spiral. In my darkness, I was living there, and my darkness was only going to get darker. But I encountered this person of Jesus Christ. I realized what he offered me. I saw the light of God, and I stepped into that through faith and belief in Jesus Christ, and everything changed. My darkness turned to light. My blindness turned to sight. Everything about me is different than it used to be. Aren't you glad that when we meet each other in the church that we've already been changed? Because I probably wouldn't like many of you the way you used to be. Right, Bear? I just wouldn't like you. But it's good that real transformation brings us from darkness into light. And this is what John is talking about. Anyone who denies the Son doesn't have the Father, but anyone who acknowledges the Son has the Father. So we come together in this place of community called the church. We come together in these little local gatherings, and we engage each other, and we fellowship, and we share life together, and we do life together because we have this common faith that is built on Jesus Christ. It is built on us being transformed through the power of the Holy Spirit. Our spirits bear witness with each other. Next, John moves on to abiding reassurance. How many of you like assurance about stuff? I really like to be reassured when I talk to my finance guy. I always want my finance guy to tell me the truth. I don't want a bunch of smoke and mirrors when it comes to my money. You know, I want to be reassured that the way I'm going is profitable and it's good for me in the long run. I want to know that this faith journey that I've begun, I want the reassurance and I want confidence that on the backside of things, everything that I put my hopes and dreams in is accurate and true. And that's what John does. John is now going to give us some reassurance about our faith. Look with me at verse 24. So, you must remain faithful. That's a contrast to the people that were here and left. They weren't faithful. Remember those that came and stayed for a while, then they left? So John is saying, you must remain faithful to what you have been taught from the beginning. What have we been taught from the beginning? That Jesus is God in the flesh. He lived a perfect life. He died for the sins of the world, resurrected on the third day, ascended to heaven. He's coming back again. He's saying, remain faithful to the truth of the gospel. Remain faithful to what you've heard from the beginning, because if you do, you will remain in fellowship with the Son and the Father. Again, he comes back to this idea of the proper understanding of Jesus. If you remain faithful to these things, you will remain in fellowship with the Son and with the Father. And in this fellowship with the Son and the Father, we enjoy eternal life as he promised. See, when he says if we remain in fellowship, he's not talking about losing our salvation. He's talking about this false teaching that has brought insecurities about Jesus into their life. Because see, as believers, we are confident in what we know about Jesus Christ. But false teachers raise up questions. False teachers say, well, Jesus was a good man, but he might not be God. Well, wait a minute, if Jesus ain't God, I'm still lost in my sins. My eternal destiny is not secure if Jesus isn't God. Or these false teachers begin to say, teach other heresies. They begin to teach different things that, oh, if you want to go to heaven, you got to believe in Jesus and you have to go out every Saturday morning and pass out tracts and bother people. Well, that's not true. Or he says, you have to follow Jesus, and you have to live a perfect life. And if you don't live a perfect life, then you might not get into the kingdom. Wait, man, I got to wait till the end to see if I get in the kingdom? Are you kidding me? I'll be a ball of nerves. I'll be a nervous wreck. I need to know now, either I'm in or I'm not. The truth of Scripture, my fellowship with the Son, which is fellowship with the Father, which is fellowship with the Holy Spirit, tells me one thing this morning. I may not be all that in a bag of chips, but I'm on my way to heaven. That's good news for all of us. And this is what John says. This truth brings confidence. This truth brings reassurance to your Christian faith. Verse 26, I'm writing these things to warn you about those who want to try to lead you astray. Because people are always going to try to lead us astray. You know what that's called? That's called online pornography. Always trying to lead us astray. If it's not online pornography, then it's something else. Something is always there to lead us astray. I'm writing you these things to warn you about those that want to lead you astray. But You don't have to be led astray, church. You have received the Holy Spirit. You have received an anointing, and He lives in you. He abides with you. The Holy Spirit is continually present within you. So you don't need anyone to teach you what is true. For the Spirit teaches you everything you need to know, and what He teaches is true. It's not a lie. So just as the Holy Spirit taught you, remain in fellowship with Christ. So first of all, we need to establish that there are powers, the influence of the Antichrist, are trying to lead us astray in terms of our relationship with God. But now I need to explain this next part of the verse, because some people don't quite understand this. Because the Holy Spirit lives in you, you don't need anyone to teach you what is true. For the Spirit teaches you everything you need to know, and what He teaches is true. Understand, this is not suggesting that they did not need sound biblical teachers, that they did not need pastors, that they did not need shepherds, or that these Christians knew everything they needed to know. Because some churches will tell you, well, you don't have to study your Bible, just whatever the Spirit shows you is true. That's not true. Because my Bible tells me that Satan is an angel of light. My Bible tells me that Satan is a deceiver. My Bible tells me that Satan will make something look right when it's really not right at all. He's not saying, well, just what do you think about the Bible? The Holy Spirit will give you the truth? No. Satan will give you something that you think is the truth. What is John talking about in this passage? It means that as a congregation, as a group of believers, they did not need anyone to teach them essentials of faith. You, as a congregation, I hope and I pray, because the Spirit of God indwells each of you as an individual believer, I hope and I pray that you will know when something is wrong about the teaching of Jesus. I hope you can... The Holy Spirit will reveal to you when something about Jesus is wrong. Because understand, Jesus is the linchpin in this whole thing. Antichrists are not the churches that speak in tongues. Antichrist is not the church that dips the bread in the communion cup. That's not what we're talking about. False teaching is when they get the person of Jesus Christ wrong. If a church wants to worship with just a piano, that's fine. If a church wants to worship with flags and banners, that's fine. Those are methods, methodologies. What we're talking about is theology, the teaching of Jesus, right or wrong, and hopefully you know what's right. If I ever sit up here in a white wingback chair with sunglasses on and tell you, let's all move to Guyana because Jesus told me so, I hope you take me out back and beat the crap out of me. Right? Because you know that's wrong. Yes? Jesus didn't call all of us to move to Guyana and drink the Kool-Aid. You know, by the witness of God's Spirit in you, the Holy Spirit, the truth about Jesus. Who He is, what He has done for us, and why Jesus is God in the flesh. So that's what John's talking about. He's talking about you don't need anyone to teach you the basics because the Holy Spirit reveals that to you. Now, on the flip side of that, how many of you know Hebrew? Anybody? How many of you know Greek or Aramaic? Then how can you really study God's Word if you don't know the original language? See, the point is this. We have translations, and we hold to the truth of these translations. We look at the historic teachings of Jesus Christ. We look at the historic apostolic teachings of who God is and who the Holy Spirit is. And based on our reading of the Word, we stand with them in this pool of history. When somebody shows up and say, well, you know, I was taken up in the third spirit last night and God revealed this to me. Oh man, stay away from that guy. Because Solomon said there's nothing new under the sun. The truth of God is contained in these 66 books. It has been broken down. It has been studied in the original language by people much smarter than us. In sound Bible teaching. Historic, apostolic, orthodox Bible teaching is what we are a part of today. So when somebody finds something new, Oh, look. They got something new down at this church. Let's all run over there. Ah, maybe not so much. The faith that the false teachers were denying. The false teachers were denying this historic faith. When you think about the historic teachings of Scripture, I think of one man. I think of Billy Graham. That dude gets it right every time. I never heard Billy Graham get it wrong. I've never heard Billy Graham say, oh, by the way, God showed me something in a revelation last night, and here's this new word from God. I've never heard Billy Graham do that. I've heard Antichrist do that. I've heard false teachers do that. Historic grounding in the truths of this book that have stood the test of time. That's the Christian faith. That's what we preach, that's what we teach, and that's what we hold on to. Sound Bible teaching reassures us of our salvation. It doesn't bring questions to our salvation. So, what's the authentic marks of a believer? So far in these first two chapters, chapter 1 and chapter 2, John has given us 6 marks, and I want to show them to you here before we close up. 6 marks of authentic believers. That's what we're talking about, authenticity in our Christian faith. Not knockoffs, not imitations, not fakes. We're talking about genuine Christian faith. What are 6 of the marks? John showed us these 6. Number 1, through the person of Jesus Christ, Christians, believers, have fellowship with one another and God. True believers meet together and have fellowship. True believers don't sit in the lake thinking about God. You can do that on Saturday. You can do that on Sunday afternoon. True believers gather for a relationship with each other and to hear God's preaching. Now understand, there's balance here. If you're going on vacation, you're going on vacation. If you're going deer hunting, you're going deer hunting. If you're sick, you're at home. If it's your anniversary, you go away. If you're going on a cruise, you go on a cruise. If you go to Arizona for the winter, you go to Arizona for the winter. Understand, there's balance here. But what John has showed us, that those who name the name of Jesus desire to gather together in worship and song. They desire to worship through giving. They desire to worship through fellowship. They desire to worship through prayer. They desire to gather together and greet each other and encourage each other. That's a mark of the Christian faith. So when people come amongst us and they leave us, they don't want to be here. Why? Maybe they've never been transformed in the way we have been transformed. Second mark, believers walk in God's light. That's what John said in chapter 1. He said, believers walk in God's light, and when they fail, they confess and they keep moving on. We read in the book of Psalms, I think, though a righteous man falls down 6 times, 6 times he gets up. That's what we do in the Christian faith. When we slip into darkness, we have issues and problems. We confess that and we get right back on track again. John also taught us that believers obey God's commands and they live a Jesus-like lifestyle. Obedience is a mark of our faith. Disobedience is a mark that we don't have any faith. Believers obey God's commands and we live a Jesus-style life. Not all the time. None of us are perfect. But there's a call to us to live differently than those in the darkness. Would you agree? Amen. Fourthly, John says, believers must manifest genuine love and concern for all people, especially brothers and sisters in Christ. We're to love all the world, especially brothers and sisters in Christ. You know who you should treat better than anybody on the planet? Brothers and sisters in Christ. I hope you start treating me like that. And I should treat you better, right? Because I think Paul says, continue to do good, especially to those in the household of faith. We should treat each other so good. We should treat each other so well. That's why we're going out to get wood next Saturday. So that those that struggle through a cold winter, those that are older, those that are on a fixed income, those who are single, those that are alone, that we can help them with the love of God and a warm house. Believers, we must manifest the genuine love and concern for all people, especially brothers and sisters. Fifthly, believers don't love or pursue the world or any of its enticements. You see, those in the church have a different priority. Not that you can't enjoy the things God's given you. I hope you do enjoy the things God's given you. But the priority is God's kingdom is at the center of my life. And I'll do these other things as time allows. I'll enjoy these other blessings of God. I will not let the blessings God's given me take the place of God in my life. Do you see the difference? That's what he's talking about. Believers don't pursue the world or any of its enticements. Of course we got to live here. Of course we want nice things. I hope some of you go out to breakfast after church. That's a blessing from God. But don't let his blessings take the place of him. There's a balance and there's a priority that we need to get in place. And then sixthly, believers embrace sound doctrine. The marks of a true believer is that they embrace the historic, apostolic, orthodox teachings of Scripture. Those things that have been arm wrestled with by scholars and theologians throughout the centuries. They've done the heavy lifting so that we can enjoy this Christian faith. Believers embrace sound doctrine and they reject false teaching. And false teaching always revolves around the person of Jesus Christ. When they begin to tell you that Jesus was created by God or Jesus is somebody other than God in the flesh, that's false. It's just not true. Or that Jesus' death on the cross did not atone or cover the sins of the world. Or that Jesus is not enough for our salvation. Run from those people. So, three questions. Worship team, why don't you come up? We need to get ready to finish up here this morning. Three questions for you, church. First of all, John started by saying, "Dear children, the last hour is here." So here's my question, Christian. Here's my question, church. If the last hour is here, does this matter to you? Do you care if the last hour is here? Does it change your thinking, realizing that human history is winding down? And if I understand that we're in the last days, what do I need to change in my life? What should I be doing differently because we are running out of time? What should I be doing differently because for some people today is their last day? Should I be living differently? Should you be living differently? And as a Christian, if we say these are the last days and that doesn't matter to you, then we need to have a whole different conversation. Thirdly, false teachers, antichrists, have saturated religion. Religion, and I use that term loosely, religion is saturated with false teachers. And the spirit of the antichrist is running rampant in our country. The spirit of the antichrist, they're fighting against us. Nobody wants the church to win in this culture. Sometimes it even seems like our own government is fighting against us. False teachers have saturated religion and the spirit of the Antichrist, the opposition against the church, the opposition against Jesus, the opposition against Christians is rampant in our country. So I have two questions. What are you doing to be more biblically grounded in God's word so that the Antichrist will not fool you and lead you astray? And then secondly, what are you and I doing to help turn people's affections back to God? What are we doing? If our nation is going to hell in a handbasket, what am I doing to stand in the gap? What am I doing to keep that from moving faster? What am I doing? What are you doing? What is the Church of Jesus Christ doing? Compromising our beliefs so that we make more people happy? Or are we standing in the gap making the tough decisions, calling things truly what they are? Sin is sin. What are we doing to turn our nation back to God? And then lastly, John gives us biblical indicators to measure our authentic faith. Six things in 1 John chapter 1, 1 John chapter 2. We've looked at six things that John showed us what authentic Christian faith looks like. So here's my question. How do you measure up? How do you measure up this morning? They're in your bulletin. Look at them. Read them. Study them. Take them home. Gauge yourself. Evaluate yourself. Because here's the thing. If I'm on a diet, I weigh myself every week. Don't you? See where I'm at. See how I'm doing. If I'm in an exercise regimen, I measure that. I chart that. Some people wear a Fitbit or something like that so that they can chart their progress. So why do we take our Christian faith and we never evaluate it or chart it? We do a better job evaluating our diet than we do our Christian faith. What's up with that? You've got six things in your notes. Look at those six things that we took out of 1 John chapter 1 and 2. Evaluate your Christian walk. This morning, I don't know what you need to do. I know what I need to do. I need to seek God with my whole heart. I need to be more serious about my pursuit of things in the kingdom. I need to always spend more time in God's word and in prayer. I need to change what I need to change. I don't know what you need to do, but I would encourage you to change something. I would encourage you to consider what's been said this morning. Let's stand together and sing with Randy. As always, the altar's open, but God will meet you right there in your chair. You don't have to come forward, but I would encourage you, if you have a need, you come today. Let's sing with Randy.